The first reading is from the book of Genesis. The Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. The word of the Lord.
The second lesson, Romans 4, 1 through 5, 13 through 17. For then are we to say was gained by Abraham, our ancestor according to the flesh. For if Abraham was justified by works, he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now to one who works, wages are not reckoned as a gift, but as something due. But to one who without works trusts him who justifies the ungodly, such faith is reckoned as righteousness. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and promise is void. For the Lord brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, but not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us, as it is written, "I have made you the father of many nations." In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. The word of the Lord.
As we get ready to
to receive the gospel today, I invite you at this moment to join me in a short period of conscious breathing to allow ourselves to be centered and to guide our mind to be at the very present moment. Now gently sit where you are comfortably and gently press the soles of the feet into the floor. And feel that our seat bones are grounded into the seat. Gently draws the navel in and chin slightly bowed to the throat. And feel that our shoulders are become heavy away from ears. And our crown is drawn gently toward the ceiling. Now have your left hand gently touching the heart and your right hand gently touching the belly. And bring your consciousness to your breath. Feel that your breath is becoming deeper and fuller. Now with a big, deep inhale, feel that air lifted the chest, feel the belly. And then with the exhale, feel that belly is gently contracted and allow the air to take away the stiffness in your body. Full deep breath in, taking the freshness. And contracted breathing out. Breathing in, heart center lift, belly expand. And breathing out, belly contracted, heart center released, and shoulder relaxed. Keep the breathing at your own rhythm. And know that throughout today's practice, whenever our mind got drifted away, that's okay. Just have one more deep breath that we're doing now, and draw your mind back to the present moment. And when you are ready, rest your hands on top of your laps, palms facing up for receiving, and start to close the eyes. And continue the breath in and out through the nose, and allow your breath go slow and quiet. With each inhale, allow the breath to take in the freshness. With each exhale, allow the breath to release anything that doesn't serve you anymore. Inhale, feel that our whole body is breathing in. Exhale, feel that our whole body is releasing any toxicity, any stiffness. And on your next inhale, envision that our breath carries the color of blue, the color of acceptance. Imagine that the breath filled with light and energy flowing into our body through our crown. And the light flowing down, relax our eyes, clear our throat, release the stress in our shoulders and keep flowing down. Cleanse our internal organs and flow into all limbs, and finally reach our fingers and our toes. Keep breathing. And on your next exhale, feel that we're deeply grounded. Feel the support we have. And can we feel that we are safe at this moment? Now gently flip your palms, hands still resting on top of our laps, palm facing down for giving. I ask you for this specific moment, think of something that you can share or give. Maybe it's a good wish. Maybe it's a new determination. Maybe a little smile. Or even it's a burden that's too hard for you to carry alone. No judgment. Simply allow us to be at the very present moment. And slowly bring your conscious back to the room. Gently wiggle your toes and your fingers. And then keep your breath slow and quiet. As you slowly open the eyes, taking the floor, the pews, and the whole world around you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, 'You must be born from above.' The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to thee.
I invite you to be seated. I invite you to rest in the meditative space that Nina has invited us into. I'm going to say a few things about this story about Nicodemus, but I invite you to listen with one ear. And listen with the other ear to your breath. And whenever you find your mind flitting away to a to-do list or a memory or a worry about the future, just gently bring yourself back here and now. If you feel comfortable, I invite you to close your eyes and to trust that this space is full of the presence of God. I invite you to imagine this scene from our gospel lesson today. Nicodemus has come to Jesus alone, under the cover of darkness, in secret, in hope and expectation, in fear that someone will catch him, seeking the counsel of this wild prophet who has promised to tear down the temple. We all know in our bodies what it feels like to be nervous and fidgety, for our chests or our throat to be tight, for our breath to be quick and shallow. And maybe here in this moment, in this place, we can sense Jesus before us and feel the stillness of his body, the ease and grace of his breath. And maybe we can be calmed by the rhythm of his breath. Here in the darkness of this secret meeting. Nicodemus is a faithful, earnest, obedient man. He has spent his life pushing, striving, working for righteousness, striving to get closer to God. And he has done all the right things. He's checked all the boxes. He has been excellent in hopes of earning God's approval. He is pushing with all his weight against a door that he believes will open into the place where God is. And now this Jesus has scrambled those plans. Jesus is very clearly a holy man, someone who has passed through that door. But he and his followers are not striving. They're not worried about falling short. And Nicodemus wants to know, how can this be? And maybe we, here and now, want to know how to let go of our anxiety and striving and worry. How to rest in God's presence here and now. We've come here to ask, and we hear Jesus say something we don't understand. We must be born again from above. And not knowing, not understanding, we feel our chest or our throat tighten. We feel our cheeks get hot because it's impossible to be born again. And that means that the door will never open to us. We'll never be able to reach that place where we can be at peace, at rest, where we will belong. Maybe with Nicodemus, we hear Jesus say, "You must be born again." And we hear, "It's too late for me." And even in the darkness, Jesus sees it all play out on Nicodemus's face. And Jesus responds with compassion. "It's okay. It's okay, I'm here. It's never too late. Right here, right now, this is the perfect time to realize that the kingdom of God is already here, that God is already here. You are safe. You belong here in this moment. In this breath, in this body. Jesus says, "I see that you have been pushing and pushing on that door for so long. But you will never find God if you are trying to get somewhere else. Because God is never somewhere else. God is always here." The door you've been pushing on, it opens in. It opens toward you as easily as you draw breath. And God steps through, steps toward you. For God so loved the world that God stepped through that door, became one with this world, so that God's own unending life could be shared by all. So we could all breathe the same breath. And I invite you now to take a few more of those breaths that we share with God. a few more breaths that are God. Can we just be here in this place, saturated with God's presence? No striving, no pushing, no criticism. The door of our breath opens in. And it is God that steps through.
Lent. As we enter into prayer for ourselves and the whole world, let us attend to the presence of the Holy Spirit in this place and allow ourselves to receive that Spirit so that it might pray through us for others. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy, guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy, give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy, bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy, comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, make us servants of your peace and vessels of your grace. Take our burdens upon you, so we may bear our neighbors. Fill our cups, so we may fill others. Hold us in your heart, so we may hold one another in prayer. We remember especially Rosina, Barbara, Julia, Diane, Roslyn Galeas and her family, Jack and Alex Leibline, Anthony and Will as they heal after surgery, Zofia, the Habibulla family grieving for Asha, for the people of Ukraine, for refugees and asylum seekers, especially children, those discerning a call to ordained ministry, for Michael Califano, Vita, Malinda, LJ, for Zeke and Yoon, Brian, for Marcia, Violetta, Bob, for the survivors of the Greek train disaster, for Peter, Anne Marie, and Haley, and for the Jones family. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, especially Sharon Green, Asha, and Kristen Jones. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.